You'll notice I didn't manage to set up an X Marks the Spot interview, but I just thought I'd read that bit of that text there, because one of our values here at Open Way is just valuing the really importance of what we do with most of our waking hours. I mean, sleep is good, but and so in that sense, where we are actually is probably where we need to be. And actually our growth and development in matters of faith, and even if you use words like ministry, are really a lot to do with framing our everyday life as if that is where God meets us and we meet God in some strange way. And what we've done, for those who've never seen it, is we just have a casual interview where people, we ask them what they do, how we can pray for them, and some of you have done that, but I just thought, even though we didn't have an interview today, that's a value. So, the main idea today, Alan, in a moment I'll get you to read the scripture. We're walking our way through Mark's Gospel, and the theme is actually reframing. Some of you might be familiar with the word reframing stuff. It's not about a construction thing, but let me tell you this little story puts it into context. It's a funny, it's sad, it's poignant. So a friend of ours, mine, is with her mother-in-law walking down the aisle of a care home. Okay, you get the picture. And as they're walking down, they pass a fellow resident, and before that fellow resident has even just basically got by them, my friend's mother-in-law says, in a quite distinct voice, "Oh, she's such a bitch." Right? You're like, "Oh my goodness, like what's going on?" Right? And before you take bad thoughts about my friend's mother-in-law, who you'll never meet in this life, because she's died. But if I frame it and say, this was a lady who was in the midst of dementia and Alzheimer's, I think that helps us see that response in a different light. Right? When you reframe things, you can kind of see things more clearly. And just as an aside, you know, if in my decrepitude you happen to visit me in one of these facilities, God forbid, and I say something very offensive to you, I hope you will reframe it appropriately. Anyway. So we're looking at this, we're coming to this hinge point in Mark's Gospel, and Alan is going to come and read Mark 8, verses 11 to 30. And in the tradition that we've been following, and in the church that hosts us, when this Gospel is read, we invite people to stand, and there's a little response we say at the end. Anyway, so Alan, go ahead.
Okay, Mark 8. Verses 11 to 30, reading from the NIV. The Pharisees came and began to question Jesus. To test him, they asked him for a sign from heaven. He sighed deeply and said, "Why does this generation ask for a sign? Truly, I tell you, no sign will be given to it." Then he left them, got back into the boat, and crossed to the other side. The disciples had forgotten to bring bread, except for one loaf they had with them in the boat. "Be careful," Jesus warned. "Watch out for the yeast of the Pharisees and that of Herod." They discussed this with one another and said, "It is because we have no bread." Aware of their discussion, Jesus asked them, "Why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not see or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes but fail to see, and ears but fail to hear? And don't you remember, when I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000, how many basketfuls of pieces did you pick up?" 12, they replied. "And when I broke the 7 loaves for the 4,000, how many basketfuls of pieces did you pick up?" They answered, 7. He said to them, "Do you still not understand?" They came to Bethsaida, and some people brought a blind man and begged Jesus to touch him. He took the blind man by the hand and led him outside the village. When he had spit on the man's eyes and put his hands on him, Jesus asked, "Do you see anything?" He looked up and said, "I see people. They look like trees walking around." Once more, Jesus put his hands on the man's eyes, and his eyes were opened, his sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. Jesus sent him home, saying, "Don't even go into the village." Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages around Caesarea and Philippi. On the way, he asked them, "Who do people say I am?" They replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, still others one of the prophets. But what about you, he asked, who do you say I am? Peter answered, you are the Messiah. Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about him.
So the gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So I'm just going to walk this passage backwards in this reframing who Jesus is. And we sort of hit this hinge point in the gospel. And Anita Fast, who's going to lead us next time we meet in church in the large, is going to be working that through in the next chunk of the gospel. And so we're going to begin at the end of this passage we read. And I always feel Jesus is kind of like a sneaky teacher, in a sense. You know, teachers who trick you into learning or get you to a place where it might not be easy for you to get otherwise. So they've been on this road trip, and Jesus basically says to them, this has been quite a road trip. I've been teaching. We've been doing a bunch of healing. We fed people, as we read in this account. We've even raised, this has been a raising from the dead. What are the people... Literally, the word is in Greek, what are they saying me to be, right? Who are they saying me to be? And so the answer comes out, well, you're one of our, possibly one of our heavy hitters. Even though I don't follow baseball, there's a thing called a designated hitter, right? The special person who will, right? There he is, okay, I got that right. But, you know, you're maybe one of our designated hitters. You're maybe John the Baptist who's come back from the dead. Or Elijah, one of our heavyweights in our tradition. Or maybe just one of the prophets. So Jesus is setting them up, and then he has the sneaky Jesus maneuver. And he says, okay, you. And the Greek is very emphatic in where it puts the you. It says, you. You. Who are you saying me to be, right? And then Peter comes up and he says, well, you actually are the Christ, which sort of means in the Jewish tradition, the special, God's chosen special agent, the anointed one. And then in a surprising turn, Jesus doesn't say, finally, you figured it out. Go to the front of the line, Peter. You've got it. You've nailed it. What does it say in verse 30? He says this thing, he commanded them not to tell, and he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. That's a bit of a surprise. But I think that's a good question for me. You might look at me doing this shtick and say, well, you've sort of figured out who Jesus is, Mark. Time to move on to other more important things, like, should I buy some cryptocurrency or more of it, right? But personally, I find that's a good question to live with, because Jesus says, it's close, you've got it right, but you haven't totally figured me all out. You have an understanding, you framed an understanding of this word Christ, the anointed one that's here, but actually, that's not all who I am, what you figured out, right? Don't think you've got me in the box. And I think that's the way I get at the question when we're asked, so Mark, if I imagine Jesus asking me, who are you saying me to be? I think for me, I live with that, putting Jesus in the center of the frame, but leaving room to say, you know, I haven't totally figured this guy all out, right? And I think, you know, how do we do that? And so just one illustration is this adventure called Open Way Community Church, right? What do we say on our website here? Jesus is the center of everything we do together. Christ pursues us. What only matters is that you're moving toward him, intrigued by him, wanting to know more of him and follow him. See, Open Way is not primarily about a set of issues, however important those issues are. Not primarily. It's about figuring out how to keep Jesus at the center of the frame, but in a sense that we don't have Jesus totally figured out. We're open to where God takes us. Open way is not primarily about a way of doing things, you know, no matter how much we value sort of our church in the small, church in the large, and connect groups, which those of you who want to join us for dosa afterwards, that's where we just have a South Indian crepe, basically, with spice filling, just across the street here. Those are important, but that's not the main thing about Open Way. We're wanting to create a space where Jesus is at the center of the frame in a way that says we haven't totally figured out where Jesus is taking us. We haven't totally figured out this direction that we are on, and we're open to God's leading. You know, Open Way is not about a particular politics or language, no matter how progressive we think we are, right? Or we might think, I might think. But we're about saying, no, the main thing is keeping Jesus at the center of the frame. But in a way, we're not going to put Jesus in our back pocket and say, I've got it all nailed down. I know exactly what Jesus is about and is calling me into. That we're open to this dynamic relationship with Jesus. So I'm just leaving that question with you. You know, if you imagine Jesus saying to you, are you, Marcy? Pick one, Tim, or Joe, or Mark, who are you saying you need to be? Keeping Jesus at the center of the frame. And I think when we do keep Jesus at the center of the frame, we get to see clearly now, which, thanks for going with my musical, it's all intentional, folks. I just wasn't thinking it was summer day. But I think that's the truth for us to see. When we've put Jesus in the center of the frame, we actually see things clearly. And we see this in, I think, the progressive healing of the blind man. The personal touches I love about Jesus, right? He takes him by the hand, takes him out of the village, he touches him, he has some interaction with him. It's not a big power play. Boom, you're healed. And no matter how you think about the progressive healing, like, was it a two-stage thing, right? Did Jesus not quite get it right the first time? You know, there's all kinds of comedy skits that you can think of that would come out of this. The intention of Jesus is clear. Jesus' intention is for this man to be fully and completely alive. And I use the tragically hip phrase intentionally, since we sang one of the songs the other time we met. Fully and completely alive. That's God's intention for us. And the reason I say that is sometimes when we attempt to put Jesus at the center of the frame, you might have experienced this, you might know of people who experienced this. The center of the frame, there's this sense that God's intentions for us are actually that we are driven by guilt, that we respond to God out of fear, that we live out of shame, that we're never quite good enough. You miserable excuse for a human being. I'm overstating it. And it's interesting how that leaks into faith traditions, where we somehow think, or we can get this idea that God's intentions for us are that we are driven by guilt, that we're motivated by fear, that shame frames us, and that frames this thing. And I'm not sure where we get that from. And the most powerful story I have of, in a personal way, I was involved with a lady who was in a difficult space in her life, and she was wanting to be baptized, and she told me this hair-raising story. She says, the reason I want to be baptized, part of it, is I had a vision, and she had a tough life, I had a vision of Jesus saying to me, you are worthy. Just three words. You are worthy. And I think when we frame Jesus at the center, we see clearly that God's intentions for us are nothing to do with guilt, shame, fear. There's a place for guilt and shame, but not as a permanent state of being. God's intentions, you know, you might know someone, you yourself might be in need of a vision like this. And I just offer you a second best version, which goes like this. You are worthy. You are worthy. With you, God is well pleased. God's intentions for each one of us are that we be fully, completely alive. And so how does this framing Jesus at the center work? And this is where we get that demand for the sign. And the religious elite say, hey, give us a sign. And it's kind of like a Seinfeld soup Nazi moment. Where Jesus says, no soup for you, no sign for you, right? Because I think our traditional way of thinking is, you know, seeing is believing. And biblically, that's backwards. Biblically, when we frame Jesus at the center, that enables us to see. You know, I can see clearly now. Then I saw her face, right? Seeing is believing. And I'm a believer, not a trace. Doubt in my mind, I'm in love. I couldn't leave her. No. If I had tried, bum, 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 bum. Then I saw his face, whatever, you know, you could put your lyrics in. Biblically, it works the other way. It says when you frame Jesus at the center, then you actually will see God's good intentions for you. Because the trouble with signs, if we all focus on that, which the religious elite were doing, is that it's not a stable basis of belief. There are never going to be enough signs around for us to say, okay, now finally I believe. It's not stable. And there also, there's an addictive nature when we look for signs, because you're never going to have enough signs. And what happens when you experience the God Nazi moment, where there actually are no signs, where God is dark, where it's empty, where there's nothing? Then what? And that's where this framing Jesus at the center, I think, comes into place. When we frame Jesus in the center, we remind ourselves that God's future for us is for well-being. God's intentions for us are good, and it allows us to see things clearly, even in the dark, when there's no sense of God's presence. How do we put this into practice? How do we frame Jesus at the center without saying we've figured him all out? I'm just going to close with a very pedestrian example. It's not a come-to-Jesus kind of example, but I'm just encouraging us to experiment with ways we can do that. By our street is this row of horse chestnut trees. You know horse chestnut trees? They're a large tree. They're fruit at the end, but the seed is, they have those, they're kind of round, but they've got all these spiky bits. Kind of, they look like medieval weaponry, you know, like growing on trees. But they begin, you might have seen them, they're just ending now. They begin with this sort of tapestry of a candelabra of flowers, the blooms. They're all over the tree. Mostly in white, but sometimes you get a pink. Now the sun's, why am I talking about trees? Well, I love trees, but that's neither here nor there. But how can you frame Jesus at the center in the ordinariness of our lives? How does that happen? Well, I could just say, isn't that cool? That's pretty. I'll wait till next spring, maybe after enough springs go by, I could say, well, maybe there is a designer or something. But the way I frame Jesus at the center is I thank the tree. I like trees, I'm a bit crazy. But and then I also mumble something like, you know, praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Here we are in this kind of random moment in my life, and I have the experience to experience something beautiful and lovely that tells me of your good intentions for us. As I said, it's an ordinary example, but I think the more we can experiment with integrating the bits and pieces of our life and sort of putting in the frame of Jesus at the center, we will see those and say, wow, God actually has really good intentions for us. God wants us to be fully, completely alive. And to know that we are worthy. We are God's well-loved children, with whom God is well-pleased. And in the spirit of Trinity Sunday, I want to just end by saying glory be to God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. So just give yourself a moment, and Lonnie, you can lead us in the response, your song, and then we'll move into prayers of the people. But maybe just have 10 seconds of silence.